فؤادك الأيام فتى
وجب عليه, it is obligatory on him, ما يقدر عليه, that which he is able to do, وسقط, and it's uplifted from him, عنه ما يعجز عنه, that which he is unable to do, وأمثلتها كثيرة جدا, and the examples for that are a lot. نعم.
وكذلك ما احتاج الخلق إليه لم يحرم عليهم.
Also, whatever the people need, and they are in need of, وكذلك, and like that, ما احتاج الخلق إليه, that which the creation are in need of, لم يحرمه عليهم. Allah hasn't made it haram for us. For you to think to yourself that the haram that's out there is a need that we need, then you, this is trying to attribute to the Sharia that is also a oppressive Sharia. It hasn't come to benefit us. When the Sharia has come to do what? The Sharia has come to benefit us. It has also come to remove from us any form of harm or anything that could lead us to harm. The Sharia came to remove it from us. And it also came to tell us any path or any means or any road that can take us to prosperity and success, the Sharia came to tell us of it. So for you to think that there is benefit in this issue, huh? That there is benefit in this issue all the time without necessity, is attributing and you're ascribing to the Sharia that there is deficiency and it falls short in what is our benefits. So the Sheikh is saying, وَكَذَلِكَ, and like that, مَحْتَاجَ الْخَلْقُ إِلَيْهِ, whatever we need until the Day of Judgment, our religion hasn't made it haram from us. So mortgage, is it in our benefits? La wallahi, it's not. Mortgage, buying a house on mortgage, it's not in our benefit. Riba is not of benefit. And for you to think that there is benefit in riba for you, huh, is saying that the Sharia prohibited from us that which the creation needed. That is that which the creation needed. Naam.
والخبائث التي حرمها إذا اضطر إليها العبد فلا إثم عليه.
The filth التي حرمها, in which the Sharia made haram, إذا اضطر, if it's needed, إليها العبد, if the servant necessity, he's been made to need it, فلا إثم عليه, there's no harm if he goes forward in using it or utilizing it. But again, with the conditions that we mentioned, he doesn't pass the amount that is needed, he uses it according to his needs and doesn't surpass it. So anything that the Sharia prohibited, what is it? Because our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where did he come? يُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ وَيَضَّعُ عَنْهُمْ إِسْرَهُمْ وَالْأَغْلَالَ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ. Our Prophet came to what? To make halal for us the good. And to prohibit from us what? The filth and the harmful things. And to also take away from us the shackles in which people have gained through their misguidance. The shackle of worshipping a creation. The freedom of worshipping Allah. Our Messenger came to uplift us, to free us from it. And slavery for creation. Allah came to remove that from us. So any filth in which a person has to use because of necessity, okay, the Sharia won't make it haram. Because it's a religion that works with what? Our needs. It works with our needs. And anything that the Sharia chose not to, permit for us, then we're not allowed to resort to it in any way, form, or shape. If it sets us in that boundaries, we believe that Allah has knowledge and He has wisdom. We may not understand why, but there is wisdom, hikmah, why Allah tabarak wa ta'ala chose it to be in this form or this way. One of the things that it doesn't fall under necessity. It does not fall under necessity. Inshallah ta'ala, if Allah gives me life to live, I will talk about it inshallah ta'ala, which is the issue of fakhu sihri bisihri. A person who's got magic done to him, can he take that magic away with another magic? لا يجوز. It is not permissible. And it doesn't fall under daruriyat. It does not fall under it. And the qa'ida, al-darurat tubihu al-mahdurat, it doesn't fall under it. And it needs a thorough explanation, inshallah ta'ala, in its place. So you're not allowed to go to a magician to say to him, I have magic done on me, and I want you to take this magic away from me by doing another magic. La yajuz. La yajuz, it is not permissible. And inshallah ta'ala, as I said, if Allah gives me umr and time, we will go through that and in another place, inshallah ta'ala. Naam.
فالضرورات تبيح
المحظورات
فالضرورات تبيح المحظورات الراتبة والمحظورات العارضة.
The ضرورات it permits for you المحظورات الراتبة, the محظورات which are sequential that go on, and it also permits for you what والمحظورات العارضة. And it also permits for you. It also permits for you what? It also permits for you the haram, the things that are haram, which are arid. They're not consistent. They're not continual. But they are. They just happen to be at that time. The Sharia permits those two types of mahdurat. Those two types of mahdurat. One is ratib. Ratib means it's consistent. And the mahdurat, which is arida, it hits once. The Sharia, what does it do? It permits both of them for you. You're allowed to use it under times of need. You're allowed to benefit from it. You're allowed to benefit from it. Naam.
وَالضَّرُورَةُ تُقَدِّرُ بِقَدْرِهَا
تُقَدَّرُ
بِقَدْرِهَا تَخْفِيفًا لِلشَّرِّ.
The Sheikh here says, وَالضَّرُورَةُ, the necessity, تُقَدَّرُ, it is, the one I mentioned before, it is estimated, it is done within the boundaries of the need. تُقَدَّرُ بِقَدَرِهَا, we amount it in accordance to our needs. We don't go beyond our needs. Why? تَخْفِيفًا لِلشَّرِّ. Because all we want is we don't want to fall into a beyond the need. Beyond the impermissibility, because we're only allowed to do it according to the necessity, so we stay within that boundaries. And one of the things that the scholars, they use to weigh what is a which one is given precedence over which. For example, if there is a maslaha which is am, it encompasses a group of people. You see? And a maslaha that only benefits a group of people, a little amount of people. But this one, a large quantity of people are going to benefit from it. And here the maslaha is only a handful of people who are going to benefit from it. I'll give you an example. A ruler, a Muslim ruler, sees that a road he wants to build. But the problem is with the road, what happens is that there's going to be a few houses of people who are on top of the road. And he won't be able to what? He won't be able to build a road that can benefit the general mass. Because he's going to have to harm a few number of people, take their houses away from them, destroy their houses. In this situation, we'll say that those people's houses will be broken down. Their houses will be demolished. Why? Because the maslaha with the benefit which the majority of the people have outweighs the what? The maslaha or the mafsada that we can cause a group of people. Like la shak, we have to give them iwad. The government has to give them back the money of their houses and pay them back. But the government will not accept from them to still remain in their houses. They will forcefully be given money. Forcefully. Because the maslaha here for the people, the road that the people need to take, outweighs this person. So there are ways to do it. And we spoke about a bit about it. The maslaha which is qasira versus the maslaha which is muta'addiya, muta'addi, the maslaha which is exclusive to you and the maslaha which involves others, which one takes precedence over which. We spoke about that. And Al-Izz ibn Abd Salam, Sultan al-Ulama, he has a book called Qawa'idul Anam, where he talks about masalih. What's the book?
قواعد الأحكام.
ها قواعد الأحكام في مصالح الأنام. It's called قواعد الأحكام في مصالح الأنام. That's what it's called. نعم. In which he wrote pertaining to the issues of مصالح المفاسد. He brings it every issue مصلحة المفسدة. How it revolves around it. مسائل. He brings this issue مصلحة المفسدة. This issue مصلحة المفسدة. This issue مصلحة المفسدة. So he called and his قواعد principles. Is Ibn Abd al-Salam rahimahullah, who used to be called Sultan al-Ulama. نعم.
فالضرورة تبيح المحرمات من الماكل والمشارب والملابس وغيرها.
Necessity, what does it permit? It permits the محرمات, the prohibited things in terms of food. So your necessity, food becomes, the haram food becomes permissible for you. والمشارب, and also water and things that you drink. والملابس and clothing وغيرها and other than it. The darura permits it for you. And of course, as I said to you before, all of that we have to observe. And we have to look at, we have to look at the principles that we put in place in the issue of darura. And a person has to distinguish between the difference between darura and hajiyat. The things that are something that is a darura, something that's haja, and that's something that which are the mukammilat. A person has to know the difference between them, so he doesn't mix up the matter. Naam.
وَمِنْهَا الْأُمُورُ بِمَقَاصِدِهَا.
Now the sheikh is going to move on to another qa'ida, which is from the قواعد الكلية الكبرى. The sheikh is moving on to it now. And what we've mentioned so far are the قواعد الكلية الكبرى. The first one that we mentioned, which one was it? اليقين لا يزول بالشك. And the second one was what? The second one was أن المشقة تجلب التيسير. And now the sheikh is moving to الأمور بمقاصدها. As for the قاعدة اللا واجب مع العجز ولا محرم مع الضرورة. Also it's from the قواعد الكلية الكبرى. It falls under it. Are you with me? It falls under it. What does it mean قواعد الكلية الكبرى? It means these قواعد are متفقون. It's agreed, unanimously agreed upon by the فقهاء. Other قواعد, scholars, they differ on it. Other scholars, they differ on these قواعد. Some say these قاعدة, for us, we don't accept. And some say, نعم, we accept these قاعدة. As for these five, they are unanimously agreed upon. And الإمام السيوطي in his كتاب الأشباه والنظائر. الإمام السيوطي in his كتاب الأشباه والنظائر, the way he authored it was what? He first of all speaks about these قواعد الكلية الكبرى, these five first. And he talks about them. Once he finishes speaking about these five قواعد الكلية الكبرى, he then goes on to those who are distinguished, those who are disputed, the قواعد which the scholars dispute on, which are called القواعد المختلف فيه, the قواعد which are disputed in its regard. Why would it be disputed? Because every madhab has usul, which it picks up from, and they differ from how they look at it. As for these five, they are محل اتفاق. It's a محل اتفاق. They agree upon it. نعم. So here we have الأمور بمقاصدها. الأمور بمقاصدها. And we spoke about this before. The usage of the word الأمور isn't an appropriate usage. We said this before. And it's better to stick with the ألفاظ الواردة that have been transmitted in the Sharia. So it's best to say الأعمال بالنيات. Or إنما الأعمال بالنيات. As the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the hadith which is in Sahihain, من حديث عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه, that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did he say, إنما الأعمال بالنيات. That verily every action is what is intended from it. So this qa'idah is very powerful. And it's the qa'idah which the scholars, they take, it's the qa'idah which the ulama mentioned, it goes into just about every field of مسائل الفقه. And Islam and fiqh, a lot of it revolves around looking at people's intentions and what they mean by it. When it comes to the issue of talaq, if the person's divorced, that he divorces his wife, and the speech that he uses to divorce his wife, if the kalam is kinaya, it's a kinaya, it's indirect. You see, his intention is what is observed and is looked into. As long as there's what? As long as the situation doesn't already tell us. If there is no clarity regarding the qara'in, the external, outer, doesn't give us any sign of what he meant. Okay? If that gives us a sign, then of course we don't need to know what he meant by it. Because the qara'in, you see, and etc. So it's important that that a person knows this qa'idah and he understands it. And this qa'idah, we spoke about it in excessive details when we were talking about it in the sharah of Umdatul Ahkam, when we were doing the sharah of Al-Arba'in al-Nawawi, Imam al-Nawawi sharah. And we also spoke about it in what? We also even spoke about it in the qawa'id al-fiqhiyya by Sheikh AbdulRahman Nasir Sa'dee, rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. That the sharia, it observes and it looks at the maqasid al-mukallafin, the intentions that the person, what he meant by what he said. And based on this qa'ida, the issue of hiyal has been prohibited. Hiyal, which means that a person can't try to make, hiyal is when a person, for example, something was made haram from you, but you go another way to make it halal for yourself, indirectly. You make it for yourself, for example, a man divorces his wife, and the divorce is baynuna til kubra. All of the divorce is gone. All of the divorce, he finished them all. And now the woman has to go what? And get married to who? She has to marry another man. As Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala said, حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ, until she goes and marries a man other than him. So he wants his wife back so badly. So he tells her, go and get married to another man. And come back to me after you've left him. Now, wasn't that the condition for him to get married to her? Yes, it was for her to get married to another man. And then he is permitted and allowed to get married to his wife. So what he does is that he tells her to do the process. And he tells her to leave the guy after a what? And he also tells the guy, you're going to have to leave my wife after a day or two. Or straight away after the marriage happens, you're going to have to let go of my wife. This in the Sharia is prohibited. Why? Because the intention, if this happened without that intention, it was permissible. All of that which is taking place. And on the other hand, we have the same situation that took place, but none of them planned it out. The woman actually did want to get married to this second man after her husband divorced her, and she saw that she doesn't like him. She saw herself not interested in this guy. She said, you know what, let me go. I don't really feel interested in you. And she leaves him. Her husband finds out that she's divorced, and then he goes and gets married to her. What was the difference between the two? Just the intention. So it shows you how the intention alone, ahkam, are based on it. Look at this. Two people are praying on the first line of the masjid. Both of them are praying in the first line of the masjid. One gets rewarded for it, another one gets punished for it. Why? Are they both doing the same action? They are. One is doing it for the sake of Allah, and another one is doing it for who? To show off. He's doing it for somebody other than Allah. And you see, the only thing is that their action is the same. They came into the masjid at the same time. They both left the masjid at the same time. They both prayed in the same line, shoulder to shoulder, in the first line, right behind the imam. One is rewarded and the other one isn't. Why? The intention. The intention. A man says to his wife, you're divorced. Another man says the same. One is actually married to his wife still, and another one is not even married to his wife. Why? Because one said it. One said it because his wife was trapped in a place. Are you with me? She was trapped in a place. And so he was letting her free. And he said it. He said it to say, you are free. I free you. The other one, when he said it to her, he said, I free you. But he meant, I divorce you. I don't want to be with you anymore. All of that is based on what? Based on the intention. And the intention determines it. So that's why it's very important. So when you go to Kutub al-Ibadat, you go to Mu'amalat, and you also go to the Huquq or Khalq, the maqsad and the intentions is always observed. It is what? It's always observed. Na'am.
فَيَدْخُلُ فِي ذَلِكَ العبادة والمعاملات والتحريم الحيل والمحرمة
المحرمة
مأخوذ من هذا الأصل.
See, this al-umuru bimaqasidiha, al-a'malu bin-niyat. It enters al-ibadat. It enters al-mu'amalat. And based on just this qa'ida, the hiyal is being prohibited. Al-muharramati, which is haram. Ma'khudhu min hadha al-asli. It's taken from this asal. Walidhalika, the bay'u could, the people, bay, they call it bay'u al-'ina. Bay'u al-'ina, which is a form of hila. Hiyal, a person trying to go behind, it's also prohibited. Based all of that on the intention. Na'am.
One siraful al-fadil kinayati wal-muhtamalati ila sira
wal-muhtamalati
ila sira'ihi min al-hadha al-asl wasuwaruha kathiratun jiddan.
This one he says, وَانْصِرَافُ أَلْفَاظِ الْكِنَايَاتِ. And the أَلْفَاظِ الْكِنَايَاتِ are أَلْفَاظِ which are indirect. Kinaya is anything that's غَيْرَ صَرِيح. It's not direct. Also, the wordings which are kinayat and the muhtamalat. Kinaya and muhtamalat are. Kinaya is indirect. Muhtamalat is anything that can take more than one meaning. There's a possibility it could mean this. It's a possibility it could mean that. إلى الصراح إلى الصرائح من هذا الأصل وصورها كثيرة جدا. All of that, the kinayat that a person, the words that the person uses, which is a kinaya, the words which a person uses, which are muhtamalat, it can take more than one meaning. All of them, they fall under this qaida and they have a portion in it. They all have a man divorces his wife and he uses a kinaya or he uses a statement of al-fadh which are muhtamala, it can carry this meaning and it can carry that meaning. What do we do? فَإِنَّا نَنْظُرُ إِلَى نِيَتِهِ. We want to look at your intention. We ask the person, what do you mean by it? And we base that ruling on it, what? We base it upon what? اللَّفْظ بِنَا عَلَى تِلْكَ النِّيَّةِ. We base it upon his intention. Because the word can mean more than one meaning. So he's trying to say to you the kinayat and the muhtamalat are all, they fall under الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. So you ask the person, Akhi, what did you mean? But I already mentioned this to you. As long as there is not a qara'in that determines already. Naam.
وَمِنْهَا يَخْتَارُ عَلَى الْمَصَالِحِ مَصْلَحَتَيْنِ وَيَرْتَكِبُ أَخَفَّ الْمَفْسَدَتَيْنِ عِنْدَ التَّزَاحُمِ.
The Sheikh now is talking about a qa'ida which is very important. Qa'ida which is very important. Which is يختار, the person chooses أعلى المصلحتين, the two مصلحة that are running shoulder to shoulder besides one another. You're going to take the greatest of the two. ويرتكب, and the person will also have to do أخف المفسدتين, that if he has to do one of these harms, he has to do one of them, he's going to take the less one. عند التزاحم, when they are both push and pulling each other. A person is forced to choose from what? If there's two مصلحة, which one do you do? If there's two maslaha, which one do you do? You do the greatest of the two maslaha. You do the greatest of what? Of two maslaha. And if there is two mafsada, and you have to do one of the two mafsada, what do? You do the lesser of the two mafsada. I gave you an example of al-muqaranatu bayna al-masalih wal-mafasid. And I gave you an example. For example, the government, it sees, the Islamic government sees the need of what? Of having to make a road here. It sees that there's a need for it. Because the previous road, many accidents were taking place and it was so narrow and etc. So the leader sees that he has to make a road here. And it's going to involve a handful of people's houses to be demolished. He will do it. He will what? He will give the maslaha which is general, which is amma, over the maslaha which is what? This person is maslaha. Na'am, it's a maslaha for you to live in your house, and it's a maslaha for that person to live in their house. But your maslaha is now in contradiction to the greater maslaha. We give precedence over to the greater maslaha over your individual maslaha. Over your individual maslaha. So now it becomes permissible for the leader to break those houses, and he has to give them what? Iwad. He has to give them a fine money in return, or another house in return. Or another house in return, whichever they agree upon. The mafsad is the same. There's a mafsada. The person has to do two mafsada. There's no other. There's no maslaha or a mafsada. It's two mafsada. He has to take it. For example, a woman who her and her husband were traveling in the middle of the desert. The husband passes away, but he stops in a village. He stops in a town. And they stay there over the night, and in the morning she discovers that her husband is dead. Or even in the middle of the desert, her husband passes away. Now what do we have? This woman, there's a mafsada if she goes forward and she travels by herself, she falls under the prohibitions of what? The prohibitions of the hadith, أَيُّمَا إِمْرَأَةٍ. Any woman who travels, أَمَا لَا يَحِلُّ لِمْرَأَةٍ أَن تُصَافِرَ إِلَّا وَبَعْهَا ذُو مَحْرَمٍ. A woman is not permitted to travel except there is a mahram with her. She can't travel. So that is a mafsada. So we have to see there's a mafsada here. And there's also another mafsada, which is mafsadatul ghurba. She has to stay as a stranger in a land where any problem she can go through. Or she's going to be in the middle of the desert and more harm can happen to her as well. If she stays there and never move from there, she can die out of hunger, she can die out of thirst, etc. So we have here two mafsadas running beside one another. Which of the two mafsadas do we take? We take the mafsada of telling her to move forward. And we tell her to go to her destination. We tell her to what? We tell her that this is the mafsadatul aqal, the lesser of the two evils, for you to travel without a mahram. So we're doing that. Why? Min dar'il mafsadatil a'la. Because we're trying to repel and get rid of the greater mafsada of you staying in the land where you're a stranger. Or you stay walking by yourself or living by yourself in the middle of the desert with that small maintenance. Nope, you keep it moving and you go to your destination. You see how the Sharia observes all of that. So it's called يختار أعلى المصلحتين ويرتكب أخف المفسدتين عند التزاحب. نعم.
وعند التكافؤ
وعلى
هذا الأصل الكبير ينبني مسائل كثيرة.
وعلى هذا الأصل, based upon that أصل الكبير, this great أصل, ينبني مسائل كثيرة. A lot of مسائل are built on it. مسائل الجهاد, مسائل الدماء, مسائل إمارات, إمارة, leadership of a government. All of these matters are looked at مصالح المفاسد. A رعاء, a person who doesn't know nothing, who's a na'iq, who doesn't understand much of the religion, for him to take the banner of telling moving the whole ummah into the masalih and the mafasid, these matters are not for you. The maslaha and the mafsada are weighed by who? Ulama, the scholars and people of knowledge. Because when they look at the masalih and they look at the mafasid, based on that they sent a hukum and a ruling. ولذلك, if you look at Islamic history, whenever a people turned away from the ulama and they chose not to follow the statements of the ulama, what happened? They saw mafasid, harm, mallahu bihi alim, only Allah knows. Imam Ahmed, for example, Imam Ahmed, he saw the Jahmiyyah to be kuffar. And I remember when I brought you the qawl of Imam in our sharh kitab, Lamiyyah ibn Taymiyyah, I brought to you guys what? The statement that Imam ibn al-Qayyim said in his kafiyyatu shafiyyah, في الانتصار لفرقة الناجية, his نونية. He said, وَلَقَدْ تَقَلَّدَ كُفْرَهُمْ خَمْسِينَ مَعْ عَشْرٍ فِي الْعُلَمَاءِ فِي الْبِلْدَانِ وَاللَّالَكَائِيُّ. He said 50 times 10, 500 scholars transmitted it. Abu Qasim Hibatullah al-Lalakaiyu transmitted their kufr and their kuffar. Are you with me? In his book, شرح أصول اعتقاد أهل السنة والجماعة. Before him, who brought that ijma? Imam al-Tabarani. Before Abu Qasim Hibatullah al-Lalakai, Imam al-Tabarani transmitted the kufr in the statement of the Jahmiyyah, which is that the Quran is created and that their belief is kufr. Imam Ahmad did that. And the same statement was said by the Mu'tazila, who whipped Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal in prison. Pay attention to this. Imam Ahmad got beaten so severely, rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah, that he would faint. He would wake up. They still beat him, rahimahullahu ta'ala. And they imprisoned him in his house and they prohibited him from talking and everything. That being the case, And they killed some of them. Like Imam al-Buwayti rahimahullah. And Imam al-Buwayti rahimahullah min talamidati al-Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i, Shafi'i student. They killed him due to the issue of Khalq al-Quran. A lot of died. Hamad ibn Nu'aym al-Khuza'i. They killed him as well. All of these were killed in the matter of Khalq al-Quran. And they died. A handful of them died. That being the case, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, when they came to him and they said, listen, these men are speaking a statement which you admit that it's a statement of kufr. You're stating that, Imam Ahmad. Can we uprise against them? Imam Ahmad said a statement which is very powerful. He said, Ad-dima, blood. Inni la ara dhalik. I don't see this. Kaffarahum. Imam Ahmad said to be kufar. But the difference between Imam Ahmad's statement, Ibn Taymiyyah brings that. Imam Ahmad farraqa bayn al-takfir al-mutlaq and takfir al-muayyan. Imam Ahmad, his takfir was general. Amma, as for the placing of the takfir ala a'yan al-jahmiyya, a'yan al-mu'tazila, Imam Ahmad didn't do that. Rather, it was narrated that Imam Ahmad used to make dua for them. And you don't make dua for a kafir. Rather, Imam Ahmad used to order the people to pray behind them. He used to tell the people, salah behind them. If you look at his book, Sharh Usul, Sunnah, he prayed behind him, rahimahullah. Even that though, he saw their maqala, their statement to be statement of kufr. But Imam Ahmad saw that the shurut wasn't present and the mawani' wasn't lifted from them. So he didn't specifically place this kufr onto them. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. Now what do we learn from that? Imam Muhammad weighed the masalih and the mafasid. He looked at the issue in its totality. And that's how the ulama are. The same, they came to Imam Hassan al-Basri, and they brought the issue of Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, and they told him Hajjaj killed this much. And how many did Hajjaj kill? He killed 120,000 individuals. He killed 120,000 individuals. From those people he killed was who? Abdullah ibn Zubayr. In the Kaaba, Sahabiyun Jalil, killed him in the Kaaba. You see, and after did it, mocked him. After hanging off the Kaaba, he mocked him. All of that, when they came to Hassan al-Basri and they said, shall we go against him? And should we uprise against him? Isn't that a maslah? Imam Hassan al-Basri said, لا, I don't see that. And then he said to him, Hajjaj is a uquba min Allah, is a punishment from Allah. وَلَا تَرْفَعُونَ عُقُوبَةَ اللَّهِ بِأَسْيَافِكُمْ. And you guys will not lift the punishment of Allah with your swords. It's a punishment from Allah. Can you push away Allah's punishment with a sword? لا. And Imam Hassan al-Basri said a statement, وَاللَّهِ that deserves to be written in ink of gold. What did he say? He said, كَمَا تَكُونُ يُوَلَّ عَلَيْكُمْ. The way you guys are, Allah makes you a leader like that. However you guys are, and what type of people you guys are, Allah will give you a leader like that. Because he got it from the ayah, وَكَذَٰلِكَ نُوَلِّي بَعْضَ الظَّالِمِينَ بَعْضًا بِمَا كَانُوا يَفْسُقُونَ. Allah places transgressors over other transgressors. Righteous people, like Umar ibn Khattab, and Uthman ibn Affan, and Ali ibn Abi Talib, and the likes of them, they had a righteous individual like Abu Bakr over them. The likes of Uthman, and Ali, and Abdullah ibn Ubaidillah, Zubayr ibn Awam, all of them, righteous people, who did they have over them? They had over them Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So the issue of weighing the masalih and the mafasid is not as some groups who are ignorant say that maslaha and mafsada, looking at it, it's a taghut min al-tawaghit. That's what they believe. Maslaha and mafsada, weighing it, is a taghut, they believe. And they say that clearly. And I just said to you guys, Ibn al-Izz ibn Abdi Salam, rahimahullah, he wrote a whole book to prove that maslaha and mafsada is the whole of the religion. And it enters every field of the religion, and maslaha was based on it. Either you know what that maslaha is, or you're unaware of that maslaha. It is from those things Allah has informed you of. Also, the issue of maslaha and mafsada enters boycotting a Muslim individual. If you want to boycott a Muslim person, the maslaha and the mafsada is weighed, and it's looked at. If you boycotting this person, the mafsada that comes out of it is greater than this maslaha which you're trying to reach. لا شك ولا ريب. There are aqwal, of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, in which he mentions that. Al-Imam al-Shatibi in his Kitab al-I'tisam, Ibn al-Qayyim in his I'lam, in Shatibi in his Muwaffaqat, also Shaykh ibn al-Uthaymeen, Fatawa Nurun ala al-Darb. He was asked, Mas'alatul Hajr, boycotting. As Maslaha al-Mafsada looked into, he said yes. Abd Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz was asked. He mentions it's into it. So some people, the Maslaha al-Mafsada only enters what they want. And when they don't like something, they won't look into the issue of Maslaha al-Mafsada. They will make it a qa'idatul muttarida, a consistently going on matter which Maslaha al-Mafsada don't have to be looked into. So again, it is jahl and ignorance of not knowing the maqasid of the sharia, the objectives of what this religion is based upon. Na'am.
وعند التكافؤ قدره المفاسد أولى من جلب المصالح.
When they're both equal to one another, عند التكافؤ, when they are both leveled, the maslaha and the mafsada are leveled, which one do you do? You have a maslaha which you can do, or a mafsada you can rebel. Which one do you do? The Shaykh said, فدرء المفاسد, pushing away the mafsada is before bringing the maslaha. Get rid of the mafsada first. Don't look at getting a maslaha. Don't think of just getting the maslaha first. Always consider what? Getting rid of a harm first. Get rid of that. Don't be like those who Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said, بَنَوْ قَصْرًا وَهَدَمُوا مِصْرًا. They built a, he built a house and he destroyed the whole of Egypt. The Sharia doesn't work like that. So the person has to focus on getting rid of the harm before trying to think of bringing any good. عند التكافؤ, when they are leveled and equal. فدرء المفاسد, getting rid of the harm, أولى is, goes before من جلب المصالح, then bringing and attaining good. نعم.
ومن ذلك قولهم لا تتم الأحكام إلا بوجود شروطها وانتفاء وموانئها.
This is another قاعدة which the Sheikh is going into. And this is from من القواعد المقررات. It is from those قواعد which are solidified and mentions in the books of fiqh. And it's a قاعدة مهمة جدا. This قاعدة which is what? لا تتم الأحكام, no حكم will complete or it will be established. Unless what? إلا بوجود شروطها, unless its conditions are found. وَانْتِفَاءِ مَوَانِعِهَا, and the obstacles that are there are removed. And you can use that for lots of issues. Salah, for example, there are shurut, conditions that have to be met. What are the conditions that have to be met? At-tahara is a prerequisite. It's a shart lis-salah. Can you pray a salah بِغَيْرِ طُهْرٍ, without purification? Can you pray? لا. And also,